Good morning. Good morning. Welcome in the name of Jesus Christ to McCownville United Methodist Church. As United Methodist Christians, we are called to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. If you are worshiping with us this morning in person, please wear a mask in the church. You may join aloud in the spoken prayers, but on the songs to keep others safe. Only sing if you are masked and 3 feet away from anyone not living in your household. Otherwise, only hum along. If you are fully vaccinated, wear a mask and sit in the designated area in the back. Thank you. The offering this morning will be collected at the end of worship. During the service, there will be a time to reflect on your offering in response to God's blessings. Then, as you exit, leave your offering in the plates at the end of the back pews. Or you can mail them your offerings to the church office or donate online. Other announcements this morning. Operation Christmas Child boxes are ready to be filled with joy and love. Please take a box and bring it back full by November 21st. We're still looking for volunteers for visuals, ushers and greeters, acolytes and tellers. If you're interested, please reach out to Paul Kreckler or Tom Myers for visuals, Stephanie Duvall for ushers, greeters and acolytes, and Chris Fisker for tellers. And now for our opening prayer. Can we please bow our heads? Lord, thank you for bringing us all together here today to worship you, give praise to you, and help us to be open to all you have to tell us this morning. Help us to be open to your love surrounding us. Help us to remember that forgiveness is the only way to heal ourselves and be free from the past. In the Lord's name we pray, amen.
time, if there are any children, they may head on over to Sunday school.
Now, if we could all please join in the prayer of confession. Awesome and disturbing God, you breathe life into each of us and call us to walk in your ways of peace. You fill us with compassion and courage, yet we often act without caution and timidity. We know your intentions for justice, yet we too often keep silent, of yield to the complexity of issues and do nothing. We are overwhelmed with your love, yet are hesitant to mention your name to another. We are forgiven much, yet we harbor old resentments, hold on to past hurts, and turn away from reconciliation. God, you are awesome in your present love for us. Restore us to clear thinking. Fill our hearts and minds with empathy and compassion. Lead us to bold action. We want to be peace-living, creation-protecting, and praise-singing. We offer ourselves to you so that we are increasingly express you in all we are and do. Through Jesus we pray. Amen. And now please hear these words of assurance. Jesus gave the most extravagant gift to all, the offering of the fullness of life and love, that we might know the way to full blessing in life. Through this selfless gift, we are set free, opened up, and released to live peacefully. You are forgiven in Jesus' name. You are forgiven in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Bob Long. I'm going to take this off for a moment. My name is Bob Long, retired pastor, and I'm so happy to be here with you today. I've known many of your pastors down throughout the years. I've watched this building be built, and I've been here to enjoy the joy that you have shared and the praise that you have offered in this place. Are there joys and concerns this morning? As there are almost always. Yes.
We would like prayer for elders in the ceiling of their eye surgery.
Thank you.
Prayers for Pastor Jeff and his family.
Prayer for Pastor Jeff and his family. Yes. Thank you. Sister who is undergoing chemo. I have a prayer of joy for this beautiful day. How blessed we are when we wake up in the morning and see rain or see sun. Yes, Jim. No, I was about to say no. Friend who has difficulties and a wife who's caring for him.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Let us pray. We open ourselves to you, Eternal One, for you are closer to us than anything else in life when we open the doors and windows of our minds and hearts. You are present within us even though we don't know it. And when we are not sure, we want to know it. You are always within us and around us. And so we give you thanks for your presence, moving us toward that which unites and creates community. For all those who have been lifted up, Pastor Jeff and family, a friend undergoing eye surgery or recuperating, Jim's friend and the wife who is caring for her, him, and all others whom we offer in our heart and mind at this time and have not spoken openly, we trust that you are always and already present in them. And we ask that you move through us to become channels of your healing. Help us to reach deeply within so that we can reach far without. Help us to search so that we might offer. Help us to receive so that we might give what is healing and helpful. Help us to question so that we might know what is good for human life and affirm it in our choices and our votes and our actions and who we are. Help us to affirm in the face of all that hates and divides, that all that misleads, that there is only truth and unity and compassion and care that takes the other as one of your children as much as we consider ourselves to be so. All these things we ask through Jesus Christ, who gives us love and gives us joy. Amen. I am becoming familiar with your order of worship as I see it flash in front of me down here.
Our scripture this morning is from Psalm 103, and it is just selected verses. O my soul, bless God from head to toe. I'll bless God's holy name. O my soul, bless God. Don't forget a single blessing. God forgives your sins, every one. Eternal love heals your diseases, every one. The compassionate one redeems you from hell, saves your life. The one who meets you with mercy, crowns you with love and mercy, a paradise crown. The one who cares more than all others together, wraps you in goodness, beauty eternal. The spirit of justice renews your youth. You are always young in God's presence. God is sheer mercy and grace, not easily angered. God is rich in love. The one who redeems you doesn't endlessly nag and scold, nor hold grudges forever. The one who holds you in hands and heart doesn't treat you as your sins deserve, nor pay you back in full for your wrongs. As high as heaven is over earth, so strong is God's love to those who love and fear God. and as far as sunrise is from sunset, the healing one separates us from our sins. O my soul, bless God. May God add his blessings to the hearing, the understanding, and the learning from his holy word. In Lord's name we pray. Amen.
I want to thank everybody who was behind the scenes making worship possible here. I'm watching all that it takes to put this on screen. I'm watching all it takes for Christine to lead a choir and be lay reader this morning, and I'm deeply thankful. Let us pray. God of love, move through these words spoken now that I and we may hear them, digest them, take them within ourselves, and put them into practice so that healing may come to us and we in our lives may praise you more fully. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Who would ever have guessed? Given the impact of the cultural struggles in the United States of America today, given the impact of the religious struggles within the United States of America today, given the impact of the political and educational struggles in the U.S. today, both the poisoning effect of resentment and retaliation and the healing of forgiveness and mercy cry out to be addressed. This morning I want to focus on forgiveness and mercy and their interrelationships. We're going to begin with a short clip on YouTube. Many of you will, and many of you will not, remember the Vietnam War. This clip is about an incident that is seared into my heart and into my mind, perhaps in yours as well. If some of it makes you uncomfortable, that is what reality wants to do to us at times. Jesus healed precisely when things were most uncomfortable. I invite you to open yourself to the healing pathway of this clip, which you're going to see right now.
I remember June 8, 1972. I saw the airplane, and it's so loud, so close to me. Suddenly, the fire everywhere around me. The fire burned off my clothes, and I saw my arm got burned with the fire. I thought, oh my goodness, I get burned, people will see me different way. Nine years old, I became a victim of war. I didn't like that picture at all. I felt like, why he took my picture when I was agony, naked, so ugly. I wish that picture wasn't taken. I went through 17 operations. I had to deal with the pain every single day. I used to compare my scars with buffalo skin. And because my skin doesn't have any pores, I cannot sweat. Make me feel so tired, so headache. It built me up with hatred, bitterness, and anger. I just living with the question, why me? Why that happened to me? In 1982, I wanted to take my life, because I thought after I die, no more suffer, no more pain. Eventually, I found the New Testament in the library in Saigon. In Christmas 1982, I became a Christian. That faith helped me a lot. Since I have faith, my enemies list became my prayer list. I realized myself, wow, Kim, you pray for your enemies. It means you love Forgiveness set my heart free. I forgive everyone who caused my suffering, even the pilot, commander, people controlling me. When I became mother, I have full time to take care of my baby. I just slowly tell him why mommy has a scar. I have to show him my picture. He touched my arm and he say, "Mom, hurt?" And he kissed here. He kissed me right here. My work with the children who has trauma like me, I know how they have pain. And not only the pain with physical, but nightmare and trauma times. Most of them, they just ask me, "Why you are naked? Why are you crying?" And I say, "Yes, because the bomb dropped and I got burned." I also show them my scar on my back. And they say, "Oh, it's so painful. I don't want that you suffer that much." And they love me and they kiss my scar. All my journey, I help children building school, building hospital, orphanage home. It's about relationship. Now I'm working, not because of my duty, not because of my mission, but because of my love.
What do you see when you look at that photo of the girl in the picture?
Now I can see the picture. I'm so thankful. My name is Kim Phuc Phan Thi. This is my brief but spectacular take on pain and forgiveness.
What I learned from Kim Phuc Phan Thi is this. When a wrong is committed, one person is harmed by another person, or one group is harmed by another group. The one who has been wronged can blame, take revenge, retaliate, and divide. Or the one who has been wronged can forgive, offer mercy, restore, and unite. Which will it be? Kim Phuc Phan Thi affirms what Nelson Mandela has said in his life: vengeance is like drinking poison and hoping it will kill your enemies. Or she affirms what Alan Payton says: there's a hard truth, isn't there, that when a wrong has been done to us, we never recover until we forgive. Kim Phuc Phan Thi's life was filled with pain, hatred, and bitterness until she became strong in trust of God's merciful goodness and love, and in that strength could forgive. This morning, I want to ask with you, what can mercy and forgiveness offer us that we so desperately need today? Charles Yancey makes us aware of four stages in the process of forgiveness. Significantly, surprisingly, the first three of these stages require us to focus within and deal with ourselves, not the person who has wronged us. First stage, I must acknowledge the hurt that has been done to me. What is the hurt? How does it affect me? What are my feelings? What energy does it cause me to invest? What changes has it made for me, even if I didn't anticipate it at all? Second stage. When a hurt is clear to me, presumably, predictably, I will want to blame the one who has harmed me. Someone hurts me and I want to put my hands around their throat and I want to squeeze. That's a very natural response. On top of that natural response, however, culture teaches me that being a victim takes away my value and my worth, and that only punishment and retaliation can make me honorable again. Culture's values mock me until I decide to retaliate. Healing begins when I enter the third stage. The third stage is surrendering my right to get even. Boy, do we need that today. This occurs when I realize that to continue to focus on the hurt and continue to punish the one who has hurt me will only cause increased and unnecessary suffering within me and out through me to others. This is the period of heart and mind conversion, heart and mind turning around. In this time of heart and mind conversion, I come to trust that it is not culture's values, but it is God's love that gives me my value. God's love is always and already with and within me. I do not have to search for it anywhere else. Constantly giving me the highest value and dignity there ever can be, even when I am a victim. God's value is always and already with me, constantly giving me the highest value possible during the injury, before the injury, after the injury, now and always. At this realization, I begin to entertain forgiveness as a possible process for myself and others. Forgiveness as a healing strategy requires sacrificial love, the sacrificial love of mercy. And mercy takes its hands off another's throat. Mercy intentionally puts away opportunities for revenge. With mercy, my vision is changed from retaliation to reconciliation. From that person is evil and I am good, and I'm going to make sure everything that comes to them is appropriate and happens, to how can I now facilitate a process that opens the way for us to live with and without within each other. At this point, I reverse my feelings until I wish for the other person who has wronged me the same things that I wish for myself as I pray to God. Nevertheless, let me say this about the whole situation. When I undertake mercy, the hurt is not denied or is not forgotten. When I undertake forgiveness, the perpetrator is still held responsible for the wrong. When I undertake mercy, consequences still exist. When I undertake forgiveness, accountability is still in play. Nevertheless, when I reach out in mercy and in forgiveness, I begin to see the other as a child of God, as am I. Now you remember that I said that the first three steps require us to go deeply within ourselves and to deal with ourselves. Finally, says Yancey, when we've gotten to this place, we're ready to take the fourth stage, where we deal with the one who has caused us the hurt. I'm at the point now in the fourth stage of actually offering the healing response to the one who has caused me this harm. And as I do, I begin to dance instead of wallow, and I begin to move closer to God and closer to other people. And I set two prisoners free, and I discover that the prisoner I set most completely free is me. And this is true of me, even if the person who has wronged me refuses to engage. I'm not responsible for another person's actions or choices or responses. I am only responsible for my own actions, choices, and responses. And yet, forgiveness is the key that opens the door so that those who have fallen into the deep darkness of estrangement may once again come together in love. Let me say that again, because if you forget everything else, I want you to remember this morning. Forgiveness is the key that opens the door so that those who have entered into the long night of estrangement and pain may reach out to one another in love. May choose one another again in the clarifying light of God's sunshine. May become determined to cultivate a rainbow future of God goodness together. Now, I expect that you haven't taken this all in one hearing. It's been a long time working in my mind and heart as well. So I'm going to briefly offer three things now. The first is that there are copies of this sermon on the table in the back if you want to further process it in your mind and heart on your own time. The copies are at the table where everybody's sitting. Second, I anticipate a question as I speak this morning. And the question goes like this: when offering forgiveness has not been enough, and I am continually harmed again and again and again by the same persons or groups, what is enough? I have to have enough integrity this morning to say that, because it is God, the source of life and love, who gives us our value and our dignity. This dignity-giving God stands with and by all of those who are continually and systematically and structurally oppressed and harmed and wronged, especially when they have offered forgiveness. The one who conveys dignity, the one who seeks us for us the fullness of life, moves within those who are oppressed to protest and require correction of the transgression. Any protest seeking full dignity for any person or group of persons enjoys and has within it the inspiration and the sustaining power of the one who loves us more than all others together. And so it's from Jesus to St. Francis to St. John Wesley to Mahatma Gandhi to Nelson Mandela and all of those who are working for people's well-being, healing, and joy today. Call for unbending, nonviolent assertiveness in the face of perpetuated evil, which is the necessary complement of forgiveness. Neither without the other is true to the gospel of Jesus. But that is the focus of another question, another whole sermon at some other time, perhaps. How do we follow when forgiveness has been received, but the evil continues? Thirdly, I want to say all this in one brief, short poem so that you might take this home easily as well. This poem was by Edmund Markham, and it appeared in the late 50s and 60s in a time that's very similar to this, not quite with the same strength of dimension. Markham wrote, "He drew a circle that shut me out, heretic, rebel, and one to flout. But love and I had the wit to win. We drew a circle that brought him in." May it be so in us today. And I'm waiting for a prompt on my screen because I don't know where to go next. Communion, okay. COVID has done wondrous things to communion. There are several different kinds of these options. And I think there will probably be a certificate of accomplishment on the table in the back today to any of you who can get this thing open. In the United Methodist Church, the Sacrament of Communion is an open table. It is open to all people. There are no distinctions. Moreover, there is no magic here. Rather, there are symbols of the presence of the Spirit of the Eternal, who is like Jesus. The Eternal lives in this life with us, offering healing, reconciliation, and peace, ingredients for creating the beloved community. The Spirit of Jesus is gift. And our response is to receive the gift and live within the gift. Thus, when we receive the bread and we receive the cup, we offer ourselves to the source of life and love, the God of grace and the God of compassion. And in doing so, we ask how that we personally and together may become channels of the grace and compassion we receive in our daily lives, so that others might know and seek the source of that grace. In this is peace, our peace, and world peace. Among friends gathered at a table, Jesus took bread, offered thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is the sign of my life. I give an unceasing, unbroken praise to the one I call and trust as Abba Daddy, in whom I receive my life. You too, do as I am doing, as a living remembrance of me." After the meal, he took the cup of joy, offered thanks to the one who called him beloved, and said, "This is a new relationship of eternal love, made possible through my unswerving obedience of love. Take this. All of you participate in this sacrament and in my life in remembrance of me. Take this for strength and for confidence as you fulfill the life I give to you. Look, here is the presence, a symbol of the presence of the Spirit of Jesus coming to us in bread and cup. Come, for all things are now ready." You may, if you can get to it, eat the bread at this time. And you may drink the cup. And there is a prayer of thanksgiving. Coming on the screen. Let us pray. Holy One, source of all redeeming love and of the fulfillment of life, we praise into the fabric of our days so that our lives may become a blessing to others. Weave peace into our words and deeds so that hatred and anger are disarmed. Weave love into our work and play, so that accomplishments are imbued with humility. Weave kindness into our actions so that the world becomes a place to live. Weave love, weave songs into our worship so that our mornings might echo in praise and our evenings rejoice in grateful thanks and all people fully live. Let it be so in us.
If we're so able, please stand and we will sing, "Help Us Accept Each Other." Help us accept each other as Christ accepted us. Catch us as sister, brother, each person to embrace. Be present, Lord, among us, and bring us to believe. We are ourselves accepted and meant to love and live. Teach us, O Lord, your lessons as in our daily life we struggle to search for hope and faith. Teach us to care for people, for all, not just for some, to love them as we find them or as they may become. Let your acceptance change us so that we may be moved to do the truth in love, to practice your acceptance until we know by heart the table of forgiveness and laughter's healing art. Lord, for today's encounters with all and bread, we need new eyes for seeing, new hands for holding on. Renew us with your Spirit, Lord, free us, make us one.
Benediction time. Oh, you could have remained standing. Usually I ask people to hold hands at this point, but I'm not going to today due to COVID. One of the other blessed things that COVID has done to us, it's helped us to think of each other deeply and caringly without having to need touch, which I understand is very precious. I love touch. Go from this place now with the understanding that God is deeply within you, within all of you together, within widening circles of this world, all creation. Go forth from this place, understanding that God calls you and me to be everything we can so that this creation may continue to be. And love, and strangely enough, joy may happen again and again and again in this day. Amen.